Kiss, they're on tonight in less than 20 seconds on R&R. Roger Rose, and welcome to R&R. Oh my goodness! Yes, Kiss is on tonight. It's wild. I mean, we've been getting phone calls and letters and faxes and Prodigy, and there's like just hundreds of people outside, and I never knew I was so popular. Later in tonight's show, before we get to Kiss, a comedian, he's the host of Comedy Central's Short Attention Span Theater, Mark Maron, and a hot young band on the road to rock and roll success, Storyville. And if you'd like to get in on the conversation, you can call us at 1-800-988-TALK. And, you know, at this moment, I'm feeling like a guy hosting a telethon. Joining me now, ladies and gentlemen, we're just going to get right to it. The two leaders of one of the most popular rock and roll bands of all time. Estimates are, check this out now, they have sold 70 million records worldwide. Their antics are the stuff legends are made of. Their music has influenced an entire generation of fans and musicians. I'm only talking about the one and only Gene Simmons and Paul Stanley of Kiss. Let's see a clip of them in action, shall we? Oh my goodness, here they are. Paul Stanley, Gene Simmons of KISS.
God, I'm good looking.
In studio. What's the matter? You don't like the hair?
No,
we should have had
a
camera and the microphone backstage. The show was back there, right? Did we have a good time?
Yes, and you know, we can't show everybody here, but can we hear you guys out in the audience here? Can we hear you for a second?
Yay!
Of all the people we've had on, you're some of them. No, of all the people we've had on, you guys, I mean, it's like the response has been insane. And I look at you and I think,
why?
Drugs, sex, and rock and roll. Am I right or wrong?
I've never seen 20 cooler looking people.
No, the drug part is all nonsense. We got serious all of a sudden. You know? No, I won't let the phrase go by. The drug thing is out
right.
The window. That's always been an enemy of ours.
Really?
That's not part of our lexicon. That's a big word, like gymnasium.
What, is that like car?
Yeah.
Car.
Yeah.
No, the drug thing's got nothing to do with us. Girls?
Yes.
Yeah, we give them drugs.
Okay. Ouch. But I mean, you know, I mean, look at the look. I mean, there's a lot of people that are watching across America who, let's say, who did not grow up with you guys or you know, are fans, and they go, they're a bunch of rock and roll freakos.
That's what we are.
Yeah.
That's exactly what. What the hell is that? No, we're having a good time. We enjoy ourselves. I mean, the important thing in life is to not compromise and do it the way you want to do it.
Right.
You know, you really don't owe anybody an explanation for living your life your way.
Yeah.
As long as it doesn't bother anybody else, I have no apologies.
Okay, none at all? How about you, Gene?
I love all these guys holding up the signs.
Yeah, you know, what are they holding up here?
It's a tribute
it's
album.
It's a tribute album.
How do the other performers do?
Did you notice that I even asked you that question? Did you notice?
Yes.
No, I didn't.
No.
No, I didn't.
Yes.
No, I didn't. Yes.
No.
Wait, let me ask you this question. Let me ask you this one.
Yeah.
Okay? Biggest regret. Biggest regret. You say you have no regrets? Tell me the one thing that slipped through your fingers of all this time. A girl, a gig, what?
A headlock will hold anybody.
Biggest regrets. You know, sometimes things happen that you don't have any control over, and, you know, it's a... You're saying regret that we have control over?
No, regret, in other words, like someone offered you a certain kind of gig to do, or someone came, you could have put someone in your band.
No.
Releasing a certain album, that could have been in your Polaroid book.
Every once in a while, you're sorry that you actually were ethical, because being unethical sometimes when it comes to somebody else's wife is...
Or somebody else's girlfriend.
So are you implying that you've had a relationship with married women?
No. Me? No, not
he'll
me.
He'll pay. He'll burn in hell.
No. But musically and, you know, as far as KISS is concerned, there are no regrets, because even though we've made, you know, lots of mistakes, real boneheaded ones.
Like
we own up to it. I think there have been some records that have been less than stellar in quality. Mm-hmm. Sometimes our vision is warped by our own sort of self preoccupations. I need a couch. I want to lie down.
It started a long time.
Do you know anything about a tunnel and a train?
I see hot dogs going through donuts.
Okay, we got a prodigy letter here. and as you know, one of the reasons you guys came on is because we are completely interactive here. And one of the things is prodigy. This is a letter. We're going to show it on the screen here. This is from Matthew Alexandris. He just sent it in. What do you think of the fact that Kiss My Derriere, your new album...
Kiss My Ass, you mean?
That one. Yeah. ...is getting lots of exposure on both radio and MTV, whereas both Revenge and Alive 3 didn't get this kind of exposure. Matt Alexander, Manchester, New Hampshire.
Well, it's interesting. I guess because we have such a wide array of people on the album, it's only natural that perhaps some people who aren't into Kiss at this point would pick it up to hear Garth Brooks do a Kiss song, or right. to hear Toad the Wet Sprocket. And, I mean, it's understandable. There's a generation. That's the first generation of people who grew up listening to Kiss, and they've all become some of the biggest bands, so we must have done something right.
Garth Brooks, on your Kiss My thing...
Kiss My Ass.
That one. He does a cover of She.
No, yes. He does a cover of Hard Luck Woman.
I knew that I was testing.
Read your notes.
Hard Luck Woman. I knew that I was testing because I was in the back listening to... that's right, it's my phone, I gotta go.
We actually just played with Garth, not the way that you'd think, but we played together on Leno's show, on The Tonight Show, and it was a real gas, because it's one thing to be in the studio with him in Nashville, because we cut the song together in Nashville. That's asked us to fly down, and it's one thing to do that, and another thing just to play live, because it's a totally different vibe.
Right.
And, you know, in the beginning, you start strumming, you're saying, wait a minute, we're not at the microphone singing the song, but it became very, very natural. I mean, Garth and us.
We're becoming America's favorite backup band.
Yeah, that's right. Check this out, though. I mean, you guys, I mean, for my image, and I'm just strictly speaking for myself, you were like the Bad Boys, you know,
that's
for
right.
a long time. It's when you did the makeup going and all that. And now, all of a sudden, I guess everyone's embracing you.
What's going on here? Nothing's really changed.
And I'm not going to come near you. Don't get
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. That's not what you said backstage.
Well, I'm lonely.
You left me a cookie, remember? I mean, it's only natural. I mean, if we were the Bad Boys, it's because we decided we're going to do things our own way.
Mm-hmm.
And we're still doing that, whether or not, you know, people catch on and all of a sudden people are saying it's acceptable. We don't care. We do it our way.
Our way. Thank you, Frank. But you said no drugs, right?
No, that's been out of the question for us. And it's not even a stance of, you know, because it would be a lot cooler to say, you know, I was a heroin addict and now I'm cured, because it's always much more interesting.
But didn't some of your former bandmates have a drug problem?
They're no longer in the band.
We had some problems, you know, with former members in the band.
Yeah.
And, I mean, the record speaks for itself, you know. I mean, if drugs really were so cool, then you'd be interviewing Jimi Hendrix, Jim Morrison, Janis Joplin. I mean, drugs kill people.
Right.
Or it ruins your creativity. And I don't think that's cool. And we've never subscribed to that, and maybe that's why we're still around at this point.
I don't think, though, it's our position in life to dictate to people or to preach, even with something as stupid and moronic as drugs. And so we won't tell somebody not to do it. We won't tell you not to jump off a building. We'll simply live by example. We believe in our own point of view about life, and we simply live it. We're not here to tell you, hey, this is the right way to
do
it.
What's your point of view of life?
You want to jump off a building, you go off.
What's your
point
of view? We got to get to a call here, but what's
your point of view? Point of life, it's Epicurean hedonism. The pursuit of happiness is pleasure, and it's my right to go after it, and if you try to stop me, you can kiss my ass.
Our next contestant comes from Illinois. Her name is Karen. Hello, Karen, you're on the phone.
Hey, how you doing?
You're on with Kiss.
Great, I just want to say hello to the guys, and let them know that I actually grew up with your music, and it's still some of my best memories are from the first song, one of the first songs you did, Beth. And I just think you guys have lasted because you have what it takes. But my main question is, what do you feel has changed the most about the music business from when you first started to what it is today?
Maybe it's become more. Maybe it's become more business, you know, but. There's a lot of people running record companies who next year may be running Tropicana or IBM. It really has become big business. But
you guys are businessmen. I mean, you really are, aren't you?
We're businessmen in the sense that if we make a dollar, it belongs in our pocket, not somebody else's. And if that's contrary to rock and roll, then screw it, you know? The idea is we work hard and we want the rewards of it.
Well, you have tons of merchandise, and we have some stuff. I don't know if you guys can get this on camera right now, but I mean, this is from one of your. This is not really merchandise, but I love this thing. It's like,
that's not good business. That's just a sad case of me wanting to get laid. crazy. That's not good business.
We are going to get to the tongue next break here.
That's a guy who's hard up and doesn't have many
sit
friends.
Sit on it and you'll make it lucky.
It's an evening. Now, wait a minute, though. You guys really have been businessmen from the start. Was not the makeup a business ploy, a marketing ploy?
We reject that, not because we think it's a negative, but because it's really not true. The truth is that instead of us being responsible for this hurricane that's lasted for 20 years, it's carried us along, right along with it. And people think, wow, look at, you know. I think it's a combination of luck and a lot of hard work, and it seems the harder we work, the luckier we get. Those are two things I stole from Paul Stanley's last interview.
We got to go. When we come back, we're going to talk more to the rock group Kiss, and also we'll be talking about all sorts of mysterious things. Call us, fax us, prod AGS. We'll be back with more here on R&R.
Bludgeoning rock to death.
I think Kiss is a lot more exciting than four slobs walking on stage who need a shave. You know, I think we're putting glamour back into rock and roll.
There you
are.
Yeah.
Oh, that was
heavy sort of.
The things we said when we were young.
To be young. Welcome back to R&R. My special guests tonight are Paul Stanley and Gene Simmons of Kiss. You were there with Edwin Newman.
Well, he used to be Edwin, but now he's Edwin Oldman.
We also were there with Alfred E. Newman, his son.
Actually, he was like your backup guy. Didn't he wear makeup?
He was actually very sweet.
And, very nice guy.
Yeah, nice look. Now,
wait a minute. You know, seeing you guys, especially back then with someone like that, that's totally opposite of your image. Was there, again, we were talking about marketing.
It was very good. It was like oil and water. You know, it was like, what planet are you from? You know, we come in peace.
We just came off stage rehearsing. I think we were going to go out on tour. And he was there with NBC and lots of cameras to find out what this whole thing was about. Little did we know that the show was later going to be called The Land of Hype and Glory.
Oh, God.
And so, you know, he was asking us questions like, well, what are you trying to say by spitting blood? I'm going,
I think the way
hello?
The show ended
it's rock and roll.
He said something like, they're worth $110 million, and that
you
was...
You know, stuff like that.
But what about that then? I mean, okay, time has passed. We were just talking about this during the commercial break. Spitting blood, wearing the makeup. You said during the break, I forget exactly how you put it. It's your words, you should put it. You know.
I think we were always trying to entertain people, and this band has always been about trying to give fans the show that they never saw.
Right.
When we used to go to see bands, you'd see a bunch of slobs on stage who thought they were doing you a favor showing up, but you were paying. And we basically got out of the audience, got on stage, and said, you don't deserve that kind of crap. This is what's possible.
Blood from the mouth, grabbing your groin, and
breaking guitars,
doing bombs
on the stage.
I'll give you that. You had puffier hair there, I noticed.
That's right. I did.
Yeah,
I moosed it.
We're going to take a phone call now. Rob in New Jersey.
Hey, Roger. How you doing? Great show.
Thank you. Say hi to Kiss.
Hey, Paul. How you doing?
Good. How are you doing?
I was just wondering, now that you have like an all cover band album of your songs and everything, how do you guys feel about, you know, the bands out there that do the makeup and do all the cover band and, you know, the whole scene? How do you guys feel about
that? You mean the Kiss tribute band?
There's these tribute bands around, and it's really it's the ultimate compliment when you have these bands who really capture a certain period of the band. They do the makeup, they do the costumes, and they recreate the show. We've never seen Kiss on stage, so the closest we've come is going into a club and seeing these bands do these elaborate shows, and you see somebody, and it's like looking up there and saying, there you are on stage.
You guys like being famous?
It doesn't
suck. Beats working.
is there a downside? I mean, you know, you are infamous. You just had a baby, right? You are infamous for your Polaroids of...
Oh, yeah, and you don't do this because it's just a good-paying job.
I'm here.
I noticed the girls were lined up on the outside going, Roger, next.
They were going, that was not for me, that was actually for you.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you know.
You just do this because...
You like
being on television.
But, I mean, come on, man. I mean, is there a downside?
How could there be a downside? It's kind of like winning the lottery and then complaining that you have to pay taxes. What could be more ungrateful than having your dreams come true and then saying, you know, I want to be by myself. I don't want the crowds bothering me. If there's any, you know, either rock stars or actors, actresses out there who crave, you know, time to themselves, do them a favor. Ignore them.
So what I'm getting, the vibe I'm getting from you guys, though, because you're talking about all this stuff, is that you're not making excuses for yourself at all. You're saying, hey, this is the way I am. Take me or leave me. It's basically comes down to it.
I think from day one, that was our modus operandi. We either had,
lexicon, modus operandi.
When you use those words.
That's lexicon.
That's those words.
That's because we're on cable.
Yeah. Now, wait a minute. Speaking of which, cable prodigy, I'm the smooth... Do you like my segue?
Very good.
Here's one from John Schaefer. John writes...
Makes a hell of a beard, doesn't he?
Yes, he does. I love his work. Gene, your stories about women are renowned. Tell me about the one you wanted that got away, if any.
I thought
that's
he was going to say your
like
story.
Is there anyone that ever got away?
No. A ball peen hammer takes care of
that. I don't know.
I love you. Yes, you do. No, I mean, look, it's you have to take all of it with a grain of salt. Everybody.
Did anyone ever get away? Come on, man. Was there one? Well, I don't want to hear it. You know.
But seriously.
Our kids. No, I mean.
What? Look, what does all that mean? You know.
But you're infamous. I mean.
But I'm a romantic. I've always wanted some very important intimacy.
All right, let's talk Cher. Let's talk Cher for a second. Now, I got to ask you, Cher, after you, has been dating nothing but young guys.
Yeah.
Now, do you feel that you're partially responsible for this?
Absolutely. Once she's
enough
had the oldest
old
living
guys.
Bitch.
I'm sorry, could you say that again, please? What?
Well, once she's been with the oldest guy in the world, why not? I think life's about enjoying yourself and not looking over your shoulder to check with somebody else, hey, should I live this way or not?
Right.
Everybody, Cher, anybody else, you know, just go find happiness wherever you find it.
So you're romantic, but yeah, you've been linked to a lot of people, and so have you, you know.
Yeah. Well, we're not antisocial. We like people, and people like us, because people.
You're opening for Barbara Streisand. Aaron Hartline, went out around New York City and asked some guys some questions to see what they wanted to ask you guys. So here's Aaron out in New York City. People.
Gene, is the myth about the cow tongue on yours true?
What is that, and what does that mean?
There's a rumor. Some of the rumors are really funny. There's a rumor that my tongue was grafted on from a cow's tongue. No, it's not true, but I do have a horse's ass that was just really molded right in.
So what about the tongue? I mean, your tongue is infamous also.
I was born that way. For God's sakes, leave the damn thing alone. It could have just as been, you know, my elbow. You know, that's the guy with those big elbows.
I've heard that about you.
It's just big. And it spins, and it's available for bar mitzvahs.
our next person out in the street with Aaron, let's see somebody else. Have Nicky.
I remember seeing him in a concert once, and I don't know if he bit off the tongue or something. Was that like real blood or what?
Well, you really have found the secret. I occasionally, when the urge strikes me, I just bite off my tongue. That's what happens. I bite it off and go, okay, time to put it back in. And then you put it back in.
Well, we'll ask you a question, I swear, Paul. Don't dare move, because we got some hot stuff to ask Gene and Paul when we come back. And it's coming up in less than, a couple minutes. But first, we have to sell some things, all right, guys?
People.
And let's show some products as we leave. Can we show some
kids? I've stated in an interview that your music is average or maybe less than average rock. And yet you've sold more than $30 million worth of records. Now, if your music is only average or less than average.
What I meant to say by that, and you really got to clarify all this stuff, is that our music is intentionally easily accessible. We don't try to make the music too complex and too self-indulgent so that our fans, that's a big word, self-indulgent, that's two words, so that our fans can understand it. And that's the kind of music we like to play. What I mean by average is that you're capable of understanding it if you've got average musical insight. You don't have to be a virtuoso to understand the music.
It's a Kiss world, and we just live in it. Welcome back to R&R. Sitting across from me, rock and roll superstars Gene Simmons, Paul Stanley, the founding members of the rock group Kiss. You had that Barbara Streisand do sort of happen in there.
Yeah, it was my attempt to have Edwin really like me. And we're really thrilled that you wanted for us to talk about Kistry a little bit, because the important issue...
I was going to do the plug.
Yeah.
You can do it in 1 second here. A summer tour of South America, playing in Nashville this weekend. And now, Kistry, a 440-page history of Kiss. Take it away, gentlemen.
It's amazing. We wanted to do a book, the book. Anything that's done by Kiss has to be of a large size. We wanted to do a coffee table book. In other words, we wanted to do a book that was big enough that if you put legs on it, you had a coffee table.
Yeah.
So we did the history of the band.
440
pages. We met with book publishers about putting this out, and quite honestly, they wanted to ruin the book, make it smaller, put more of this, put more of that in. We said, check, please. We paid for the lunch, went out, took our own money, financed the book, and put it together ourselves.
When does this come out?
It's actually not going to be shipped until January, but the first edition is being signed and numbered by the band. So we've been selling it, having people pre-order it through an 800 number. And the 800 number is 905-KISS.
No, that's not it.
Don't call that
Figure
number.
Figure it out.
That's
in the meantime,
my home.
Mike
oh
in
my
New
God.
York. Hello, Mike. You're on with KISS.
How you doing?
Okay, Mike, what's your question?
All right, I just wanted to say, you guys are my favorite, man. My favorite album in the world is Kiss Alive 2.
Great, what's your question?
I wanted to know, out of all the songs you ever made, what's your favorite to play live?
I'm sorry, what?
What's the favorite song to play live?
Yeah.
You mean ours?
Yeah.
1-800-905-KISS is the number to call for Kiss to read the book.
What's your favorite song, guys?
The favorite song to play live, probably, you know, I think we go back and forth. Sometimes Deuce.
Why Deuce?
I don't know, it's primal, and it has sort of a quarter feel on the snare and the kick, and they collide head on, and the riff is I don't know, it's just
going, I don't know what the hell this man is talking about. He's just like, all right, well, let me ask you something. Ace and Peter have called us and want to come on the show next week, probably because they heard that you guys are on here. Would you come back and do like a reunion?
We actually flew last week with Peter on a plane. And there's really no animosity towards those guys, at least as far as we're concerned. I mean, whatever press there's been, you can't negate what four people did in the beginning. I mean, it really is like family. And whatever's going on now is a direct result of what the four original members did in the beginning.
Well, let me ask you, Gene, Ace, if he was on my show next week, I mean, they've asked to come on. We're probably going to put him on, I guess. If Ace came on, what would be the first question I should ask him?
Well, the most important thing is not even a question, just that he should know we wish him the best. In fact, we made sure that they both knew that we wish him both
yeah, but
the best.
If I had to ask him a question, what would it be?
By sending a message on each CD of Kiss My Ass. We actually wrote in a message to Ace and Peter.
You did. I don't know if we can get this on camera here.
And the message really has to... You know, it's more. We did this more for us, which is why it's in our handwriting instead of the record company. Because, you know, families sometimes quarrel within families, but they can do that. Anybody on the outside says anything about bad about Ace or Peter.
What would I ask Peter?
You know, is he happy? You know, how's life? That's more important than anything else. I mean, no matter what you do, the most important thing is, you know, do you feel good about yourself and are you healthy?
Cool.
And we saw him and it was great to spend, I think we spent about 4 hours with him on a plane, right? And there's no getting away from, we did some magical things together.
Right. All right, then in that case, we're going to Alex in New York. Is that right? Alex in New York. Hello, Alex.
Yes, hi. Hi, guys. What's up?
Hi.
Hey.
I've got a question for you. Are you guys planning like a rarities album, like all other bands that are jumping on a bandwagon, or a box set?
We've been, the record company has been asking us for a couple of years about putting out a box set, and we've held off because we've really had a lot of time trying to get the squeaks out of our ears because this guy's writing on a piece of paper and it sounds like crickets in heat. But
the sign says, get them out.
Back to calls. Eddie from CT.
Well, what are you going to answer?
Anyway, there will be a box set. It will be a kind of rarities, but we won't do it like a lot of other people. It'll be stuff that you haven't heard before, so stay tuned. Same bat channel, same bat time.
Actually, thanks from here. I don't mean to interrupt you, but I will.
Please.
Actually, from here, I'm going to the studio tonight. I found tapes last night from 20 years ago of the band doing demos and other things, and we're going through that stuff to start putting things aside for a box set.
Do Peter, Ace and Chris, they see...
Ace and Peter.
Ace and, what am I saying? Don't mind me. That's why I'm the host. Do they see proceeds from all this now, or are they out of that as far as all these back-selling stuff about from the...
Once you leave the band... You leave with your belongings, whatever you take with you, and then you're out.
Get the locker and hit the road.
I mean,
they have no animosity towards you on that?
Well, you know, everybody made their own decision to do what they've done, and hopefully they're comfortable with it at this point, you know. It wouldn't seem right that you get a piece of something that...
We've kept it going for almost 15 years after the guys...
There's so many jokes right now. Eddie in Connecticut. Hello, Eddie.
Hello.
You're on with Kiss. What's your question?
Hey, I want to know with Gene. I want to know what do you guys do with all your older costumes?
I've got one of them on right now.
Oh, do you?
These pants, they stand up by themselves. We do have them. And
something just happened with your costumes, right? They were stolen or something?
Some outfits were stolen. We got them back. One of the outfits was at the Hollywood Wax Museum. It was for 15 years, we got that
Spoonie
back.
Sings.
One of the other sets of outfits is in the London Royal Museum or something in London, England. And we'll get those back too. But we have all the stuff.
Thousands and thousands. I mean, there's a whole book that we have here. Maybe I'll show it next break. There's a book that talks about all the memorabilia, and it's worth, I mean, it's like prices of all this.
The last time a complete set of Kiss costumes was sold, it was at an auction in Christie's auction house in London for $30,000.
$30,000.
$36,000.
So if like you gave me your boot right now, I could make
a lot.
Make me sick. It'll probably smell. Let's go to a Prodigy letter here and see what we got here. This is from John Strohr, and he is saying, "You said you have strayed from music you do best for various reasons, and that you have learned from it. Would Kiss stand now if you had with what is this? Where would Kiss stand now if you had stayed with your definitive style?"
I think you live and you learn, and life is about that. And often, it's better to make a mistake to refocus your vision. And I mean, if that's not clear, often you've got to just fall down in order to figure out how best to walk forward.
Uh-huh.
So some of the records we've done were not very good records. You can see that in retrospect.
Mm-hmm.
While we were doing it, we thought, gee, this is cool.
Right, right.
But it'll help us make the next record very hip.
Hmm. Can we have enough time to go for, we're gonna go one more break. Can we go one more break with you guys?
Absolutely.
You guys wanna see if they have one more break here?
Turn the car off.
All right, and you know what? There's a question one of the gentlemen here asked about chickens or something. We're gonna find out about crushed chickens.
Yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the show to watch. Call us, fax us, call me, I'm lonely. It's R&R with Roger Rose and Kiss. Stay where you are.
We're going shoes forever.
Damn it. We are back with...
That's the guy that stole my outfit. Get back.
Gene Simmons, Paul Stanley at Kiss. And where are those snazzy shoes?
We have all that stuff stored away.
Is there going to be a Kiss museum, do you think, really? I mean, really?
We're actually thinking of doing lots of fun stuff, but it's too early to announce
this
stuff.
All that kind of stuff.
We're going to do a lot of cool stuff soon.
Who'd you guys meet that was you thought was your hero? Because you have all these people here who are your heroes, but that was sort of a disappointment that really wasn't what you expected it to be. Is there anybody that came in? I thought Elvis, man, but... I don't know.
No, Elvis was lying down and naked last time
quiet.
I saw him. I do a great Elvis in Stanley. You want to see it?
Yeah, please.
Okay, ready? Elvis.
Our next... I think of an answer for this. I'd like to, by the way, thank Music Man Store on 260 Route 4 East in Paramus for giving us all these fine Kiss products. Is there anyone in particular that popped in your head that you met, even that you were impressed with?
Disappointments?
Disappointments or...
I can't think about disappointments, but you have really turned out to be a stellar human being yourself.
Moment.
Yeah,
you are much bigger than we thought.
Mel is on the phone. Hello, Mel.
Are
you're
you
on with Kiss.
Gene?
Yeah.
Paul, you guys are excellent, first of all. We all love you. I got to ask you guys a question. Does it ever really bother you when you get on these talk shows and they treat you that you're not that intelligent? It seems like whenever somebody's got long hair, these talk show hosts like Roger, I guess his name, kind of treat you like you're not exactly that intelligent.
Yeah.
I've seen it happen to Rob Halford before.
Excuse me.
I've seen a lot of guys intelligent,
Mel,
but they never let these guys say anything. Here's a man that obviously knows nothing
Mel,
about
if you don't treat us right, we're going to give him your home address.
So, Mel, quit drinking Diet Coke with caffeine. Listen, Mel, am I talking down to these gentlemen? Mel's dust. Well, that's not fair. Oh, there he is. Mel, are you there? Mel, am I talking down?
A lot of fun.
I float like a butterfly. Sting like a bee. All right. Well, what do you feel about how people totally mislabel you? Am I talking down to you guys?
I think we're having a good time tonight. And this shouldn't be taken... This is entertainment.
But when I ask you about your former partners, you guys are in the public eye, and everyone wants to know, and it's my job, and you guys are willing to come on. I got to ask that question. I don't have to ask about what kind of underwear you're wearing, although I know you'd tell me.
But the truth is, it doesn't matter what somebody asks you. You have to have your own agenda. For instance, ask me a question, anything that you think may be embarrassing at all. I don't have a problem answering any of that. Go ahead.
Okay, your makeup.
Okay, the makeup. The only way to get Kistry is by dialing 1-800-905-KISS.
Yes, Kistry, a 440-page history of Kiss, a summer tour of South America. They're playing in Nashville this weekend. What about that, though? I mean, I know you don't want me to go into the whole thing about your makeup and everything like that, but, in Japan, you guys are like Godzilla or something, isn't that right?
Yes. We are Godzilla.
We are Godzilla.
What does that mean? What's that all about?
What does that mean? Because when we go there, they try to shoot us down with planes.
Eric in Wisconsin, you got to leave the comedy moment. Hello, Eric.
Yeah, Gene, Paul.
Yes.
I got a question about your new album. I've been hearing rumors about it, and I'd like to know... What's it going to be like, and when is a tentative date released for when it's going to be coming out?
We're going to go into the studio probably around September, and hopefully we'll have it out a little after the new year. And the idea is to, make something special that takes what we do a step further. I mean, you're always trying to better yourself. Sometimes you don't get there.
Now, what about that? You guys, heavy metal. Would you consider yourselves heavy metal?
No.
Okay. I think of you as a metal band, and now music is sort of metal.
When we think of metal, we think of elves and dragons coming out of the ground.
Evil ways with rainbows and flowers and trees. It's a very good Anthony Newley, by the way.
What kind of am I? Why can't I fall
with a little Jerry
now?
Lewis.
Hello, pretty lady.
Jerry Lewis meets Anthony Newley.
You don't feel spitting blood, grabbing the groin, and explosions are not heavy metal?
No.
That's not the Carpenters.
No, I always thought of us as Elvis on steroids, you know?
There
you go. But, before there was heavy metal, we were called a rock and roll band, a loud rock and roll band. The terminology may change, and I would hate to see us, you know, spearhead this movement. It's nonsense for us to, like, champion heavy metal or anything else. We're a rock and roll band, and it seems to last. We don't compete with anybody.
So is there going to be a new sound? We got to go to a call here, but should we expect a new sound? Or
yes.
Is it the sound that we all have known and love?
Yes, we're teaming up with the Harmonic Cats.
Alex is in New York. Hello, Alex. By the way, Alex, did you know that their book, History, is a 440-page history of KISS? What's the number?
1-800-905-KISS.
And aren't you glad? Hello, Alex.
How are you?
What's your question?
Gene, I have a question. What would you guys do for a living if you weren't rock stars?
That's a fair question.
What career paths would you take?
We all had jobs before, and I think we can all have jobs afterwards. It's just that, if you've got something in your heart that you have to do where there's no choice, you just do it, and you don't worry about the consequences. And we're lucky enough to do what we believe. I'm getting choked up. It's getting to me.
Two quick questions, because we only have a minute here. Number one, is it really true that you do have that Polaroid book of all those women that you've ever dated?
Absolutely. Your girlfriend's in it, too.
Thank you very much. That's right. Oh, wait a minute. That was me. And then secondly, before we go here, you have a new baby girl, is that right? Or a baby boy?
Last time I looked, he was a boy.
Boy, baby boy? Okay.
Do you know something I don't know?
See, he was talking about that. Okay. What advice would you give to his boy if he said he wants to be a rock and roller?
I think the only thing that's important in life is not what you do for a living, it's how you live your life.
And you know what advice I would give to my boy?
We got 5 seconds here.
Don't listen to Gene.
Gene, Paul, thank you. You guys are hot. KISS, don't forget their book. We'll be back with more.